Okay, we are live. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Ruby Radio Show podcast. I am your host, Kyle Moran, and today we have a very special guest. Today we have Amber Portella. Did I pronounce that wrong? Portella?
Portella, yes.
Portella.
It's an unusual last name. It's not Italian,
I'm not Italian. I was about to go
Mario. Oh, Maria!
Actually describe yourself, Amber. What do you do? What do you do on the internet?
Well, for the most part, it's mainly reactions, mostly Rooster Teeth content, but I do react to other stuff. Like the other day, I reacted to the recent Pokemon Direct for Pokemon Sword and Shield. You could tell I was going nuts about it.
Oh my god! So, you're like a Rooster Teeth reactional channel plus a Pokemon Nintendo kind of reactional channel?
Well, not the entirety of Nintendo, just Pokemon. But I do follow like Mario stuff and all that. And like I said, I do react to other stuff. If it's really worth me reacting to.
Okay. You know, and when I was growing up, I watched a little bit of Memory, and I still watch a little bit of Fat Man. But in my deepest desires, I hate reactional channels. I just hate them with a firm desire. And I don't mean anything against you. I just think the idea or the presentation doesn't require much. You know, when you do an interview like one like this, it will like have editing or it'll have special effects or stuff like that. Whereas reaction channels are just on the spot improv react to the show. Maybe you could go a little bit more into that and explain to some people who are a little bit ignorant towards what goes into a reactional channel.
Yeah, it's really hard to say, but like one of Memory's last videos before he decided to like take a small hiatus in a way, he recently did like a little breakdown of the rules and guidelines when it comes to reacting, whether it's just the Rooster Teeth content or anything in general, that we're not making money from reacting to Rooster Teeth stuff or anything else. We're just fans like giving our support to what we love, whether we go over the top of it or just casually react to it. Really hard to explain. It's really better if you watch his video about it.
Okay, so you mentioned Memory. Is he an inspiration to you, or do you have like other inspirations?
Actually, I didn't know about Memory until maybe a year or so ago. But what really inspired me because when I was in community college, and while I was waiting for my next class to start, I just like sit around the like cafeteria, looking at my laptop, watch random videos and all that. So I even saw Markiplier's channel. And it's like, oh, that looks fun. I want to do like a little like channel, my own little gaming channel. But the thing is, but then I realized how much it costs to get a setup for a gaming channel at the time, which was 2014. Yeah, I think it was 2014. But then I didn't start my channel until like maybe a year and a half, 2 years later, when the third season of Death Battle came out. So all I needed was. Just a regular recording software, which was OBS, which is a free thing to download, and a microphone, whichever microphone works. Doesn't have to be like high end studio wise. Like I said, this one costs like $20 on Amazon, and then I'm good to go. And I just have to mess around with the OBS settings, see what's good, and then went from there.
Nice. I used a little bit of OBS, but for like the wrong reasons. I didn't really want to much like record myself or record what I was doing. I actually got into it because when Rooster Teeth stopped uploading episodes of Ruby to YouTube, I couldn't really download them easily and make edits to them in a sense. So I downloaded OBS. I think my OBS settings are a little bit messed up because whenever I downloaded it, sometimes the quality would jump between really good and really bad. And on top of that, when I tried to upload it to YouTube, sorry, block worldwide. So, you know, it's just, let's just say I had to go to external sites to get the high quality video editing. I don't have First. I don't plan on getting First. Plus, I'm getting more and more busy as I grow. So I won't have time to really get invested into Rooster Teeth content. Do you have any hobbies? I know you like to play video games and do YouTube and stuff like that, but anything else, like just to describe, like what do you like to do?
I don't really know, actually. because I've kind of gotten decent with video editing, and Zachary, I was planning on getting Photoshop to make like my thumbnails for my video at least a bit professional, because the ones that, because I used Pixlr, which is like a Photoshop copy, but really like simple to use and didn't like give me like a whole lot of options. There's another Photoshop software called Metabank Paint, which has a lot more options than Pixlr does. I mean, can give my thumbs at least a bit more flair.
But other than that, I really don't have any other hobbies.
You ever do artwork or something? Or?
Well, I draw decently, not like professionally, but decently.
I guess my hobbies are, you know, cross country. I love to run, love to listen to music. I sometimes actually make music on my channel. I have a few mashups. One of my most popular ones is a mashup between This Is America by Childish Gambino and Sicko Mode by Travis Scott. I gotta carry him. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go into this. Yeah, yeah, this is Gorilla. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go get the bag. Yeah, yeah, or I'ma get the pack. It was actually pretty good. I put out a recent one for that had Backseat Freestyle as the acapella and then Flower by Moby as the instrumental, and I thought it came out really good. You could call me a mashup artist and stuff like that. I don't make music. I can't really play an instrument. What else? I sometimes make a few memes here and there, you know, with not Photoshop, but other photo editing apps. And now, more recently, starting to do YouTube as just a fun little hobby, you know, meet people who have the same interests and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so just basically a startup channel, just for fun. I mostly just make the videos to recall what I did, just as a momentum, so to say, just as, you know, to hold on to what you did in the past. I'm like, oh, that's cool what I did. But moving on, Amber, pick a number between 1 and 2.
2. 2,
okay. So, random question of the day. If you had to listen to one song for the rest of your life, would it be Megalomania or Crazy Frog?
Crazy Frog is the one that goes, nah, 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 or something like that. But
yeah, it's the techno and synthetic.
Yeah. What was the other one?
Megalomania.
What was that one? I think I've heard that before.
You haven't heard Megalomania?
No, I think I've heard the name. I just don't remember what song it was.
It has a friendly little skeleton.
Well, I don't want to hear the damn frog all day. I'll go with Megalomania.
I just thought that was a little fun little question. All right, now to get into more of the Ruby Central question. How did you get into / discover Ruby?
Started with Red versus Blue, but the thing is, I didn't find out about Rooster Teeth and Red versus Blue till I was maybe in the 10th grade. What was it, 2008, 2009. But before then, my brother would watch like these random Halo machinimas, and I was like, I really don't like Halo parodies or whatever, but then after watching a few, I liked it. Watched a few other machinimas of, what was it called? Arby and the Chief? That one machinima, like way back when, with little Halo figures of Master Chief and the Arbiter in some guy's apartment doing whatever. And then after that, it's like other random Halo machinimas. And then eventually I found Red vs. Blue, and then I got hooked.
Have you seen the Halo machinima called Master Chief War by Guitar Hero X7? It's an old one. It's a very old one by Machinima. I watched that. My friend showed it to me once. I cracked up. I could not stop laughing.
What now, Master Chief? You see this shit? To kill all of us, you would need some sort of gun that shoots multiple bullets at once in some sort of a burst or something. But not that one. That one's dumb.
Because I never played a Halo game at the time, but I knew what Halo was, and it was just really, you know, like raunchy comedy and stuff like that. But otherwise than that, I never really watched Machinima, and I guess you watching Machinima got you into Red versus Blue, and then Red versus Blue into Ruby, right? Is that correct?
Yep.
The next question is, what is your favorite aspect of Ruby? Is it the dialogue, characters, combat, story? What is it that makes you like this anime more than other animes or TV shows?
Really hard to say, because I just watch this thing for the sake of watching. I don't really do like breakdown reviews or whatever, like how Murderverse does it, or that Kaito Dan, or whoever does review videos. But if I had to go with one aspect, I'd say maybe both the story and combat.
That's a good reason to give. For me, it's mostly just based around the combat. You know, the trailers got you hooked in that this was going to be an action-packed adventure. I believe in a few of the volumes spread out, there are some good bits of fighting. It's better than like other animes where it's always kind of like, not stop motion, but like when they hit, there's like a pause and then there's like maybe some dialogue and stuff like that. Whereas in this, it's all mo-capped or, you know, animated vocab where it's fluid. Who is your favorite Ruby character?
It's between Ruby and Blake.
And why is that?
Because I kind of somewhat relate to them in a way. Like, I can be a bit shy like Ruby, but not too shy. But I can also be a little, I don't know if reclusive is the right word, but a little, like, a bit of a loner. I like to be on my own. Like don't want anyone like my personal bubble unless I want to.
You think Ruby is shy?
Well, in the beginning she was. I mean, every other like either like manga, like the mangas I have or whatever fan fiction. I know it's fan fiction, but still, they always describe her as shy. She has trouble like opening up to people, like because. Like, she has trouble making friends.
I never really viewed her as, like, having trouble making friends. If you made the comparison of, like, Blake being shy in the early volumes, yeah, that would make some sense. But, you know, if she was shy, she wouldn't really, like talk to people, even if she was pressured into a conversation and stuff like that. Would you say, like, reclusiveness? Because that's what Ruby is, reclusive, but not shy.
Reclusive in a sense.
Anyways, tip for that. Who is your least favorite character in Ruby?
Really hard to say. I like them all, but it would be Mercury. Not just because I think he's an asshole. He is an asshole, but
it's because of his damn gray hair.
They hate you. That's a freaking demon.
Just spray that. He just goes into like the once you know he wakes up every morning, brushes his teeth, combs his hair, then just gets like a spray can of gray paint and just. No, why Mercury?
Well, one, yeah, he is an asshole, but in the recent like one of the last episodes of Ruby, I don't remember which one, where he was talking about his dad, he just like viewed the whole world like after in a way Cinder saved. There we go. Mercury, I guess in his mind he just wants to watch the whole world burn.
Some men just want to watch the world burn.
Because of his upbringing.
You don't think that's a good motivation for his character? Is that what you're saying?
I think, like I said, I'm not too much of a reviewer.
No, it's not really much of a view. It's more like opinion. I view him mostly just, you know, his Ashenholishness kind of made him like likable in a sense to me. Mm-hmm. But I never really viewed him as the worst character. I would argue Penny is the worst character because she was more of a token character. She really didn't have much depth. That would be like a really good reason. I don't know, you know, you can argue that Mercury, I don't like Kid Mercury just because of his attitude, but that's totally fine. What is your favorite volume?
What'd you say? They're all pretty good. Well, volume 5, it could have been better, but it would have to be 6. Because I like how more story to it. Oh my god. Quiet! My brother can
shut help. Up! So you like the current volume the best?
Yes. And not yeah, because it yeah, I lost my train of thought. I lost it. Damn it, Amy!
It's alright, it's fine. I would have to say Volume 3 is definitely of, you know, my highest caliber because it focuses on the combat show, focuses on the battle, and it actually builds upon the existing story of 2 and 1. Mm. So, give it some time to think about. Maybe you might change your opinion or stuff like that. What is your least favorite volume? Probably you said 5, right?
I wouldn't say, well, yeah, it's one of my least favorite, but it does have some good aspects to it. I like how like Blake is trying to like bring Ilya back to the good side after what Ilya's been going through. I kind of like that and the combat to it, but overall, I really don't like how they did with Volume 5, because all they did since they got to Mistral is just sit around in the house. They could have at least made it like explore the town a little where they were staying.
Right. Yeah, instead of being just cooped up in this nice condo with red leather couches and just packets of ramen laying all over the place. I would argue that 5 is pretty bad. I think 4 probably ranks up there actually as kind of my worst. 5 is like just a little bit ahead because that's because of the ending. I think 4 is just bad because it didn't really, even though the characters are moving, the show itself is not really, it's kind of procrastinating in a sense. 5 does procrastinate, but 5 makes it up with the final fight, so to say. I put in quotations. Now I'd have to rank 4 as my worst. What is your favorite scene of the entire show up to the current volume?
Favorite scene? When they introduce Jean's sister and her wife, I love that they brought the aspect of LGBT in this.
Explain yourself.
You think the representation of certain groups is like a big part of the show, yeah?
Yeah.
But why?
Well, I just like how like in a way brought up that no one like had any judgmental looks to it.
Although I will say I was surprised to learn what you had students fuck? Helping you.
Well, the characters, I mean, not the audience. They just casually like went on with it. Even after all that, when they went to the the ending of Volume 6, the Bumblebee portion, a lot of people like just went crazy about that.
You want to explain to me what you're doing here?
And I mean like angry crazy.
Like,
because people do not want the whole Bumblebee aspect in this.
I wonder why that is.
Like, why do you think they don't like it? Do you think it's because of their opinions on certain matters?
I guess that's one thing. Really hard to explain without having people coming after me saying with angry comments or something. But I don't know. They just do not want Bumblebee together. People even made petitions not to have Bumblebee as canon in the show.
Yeah, well, yeah, I could say, you know, I don't like, you know, certain, and then I make a petition for it, and then, you know, that's not really gonna affect much.
But here's the thing. It's Monty's show. He even planned on having LGBT characters in this. Whether it's the Bumblebee duo, the White Rose duo, any other duo, it doesn't matter. It's his show. Like I said, he planned this thing. And people are like pretty much spitting on his grave saying that it sucks. And people or people saying that Rooster Teeth is pretty much like stomping on Monty's dream. That's what I hate about it. That they don't even know what Monty wanted.
Huh. Do you still think it's Monty's show even after he's gone? Do you think the current writers take into account what he must have thought, what he was going to think of, or do you think it's someone else's show? Like currently right now, do you think it's Monty's show?
I still think it's Monty's show, but the writers, like Miles and Carrie, are still doing their hardest to like keep the show going, keep Monty's dream alive. Whether people like it or not, hey, whatever happens, I'll just roll with it. Whether I like it or not, I'll just roll with it and not make a big deal out of it. And like go around attacking like the voice actors or the writers or whatever.
Because I do talk to a lot of people. I had a few interviews with some other, not really prominent members of the community, but the fact that they all kind of have this idea that it's no longer Monty's show, that it's Miles and Carrie's show, that not only did they sort of brushed him to the side, but almost kind of transformed it in their own way. What is your opinion on that?
they'll think whatever they think, but I still think that Miles and Carrie doing their hardest to like keep the show going. I mean, it's not like Monty's there to tell them what's what. They had to like figure out how the story would go. And then the thing is, I hated that people used Monty's name in vain, like, "Oh, this is not how Monty wants it. You're destroying Monty's dream." I hated that.
But okay, I just, you know, it's a different viewpoint. You know, I have my own gripes with the show about the vision or the future or what's to come. But I could kind of respect the idea that, you know, the show was originally created by this person and they passed away, and the current remaining members of the show are trying to keep that image. Though I do think through the recent volumes, I do feel like that vision is kind of fading. I feel like in the earlier volumes, there's things that were there, like more combat scenarios and, you know, sort of quippier dialogue. I mean, the dialogue is still somewhat good. I think it's more serious now. I mean, it depends on the volume. But I feel like the show was more comedic, even in the introduction of villains and other characters. That's just, you know, my view on it. I don't know what he intended or what the writers do intend. I only can judge what they put out. All right, next question. If you could create a huntsman weapon, what would it be and what would you call it?
Actually, I had an idea for my OC, which is what I wanted to show you, but I can't find my freaking art book. As for a weapon, I haven't really drawn one because I had the idea, but I couldn't really put it down. They're like, in a way, claw weapons, because I think I made my OC a bit more of a close combat fighter, like Yang is. But she would have like claws on her, like on her wrist. I guess Wolverine like claws. It just like not shoots from her knuckles, but on the little bracelet thing, it just shoots out, you know.
Mm-hmm.
As for the name, I really don't know what to call it. I'm not really good with names.
So basically, it's just the silver characters, basically from Mark on YouTube, just a fan made silver Lien trailer, basically that type of character.
Well, like I said, it's my own OC. I drew her, but
I know. I just feel like a lot of people have like similar ideas of, you know, what weapons could be and what ideas are presented. I just find it funny. It's very similar to what some guy made an animation on YouTube. I just find it funny. I'm not accusing you of stealing or ripping off or something like that. But they'd be like a Wolverine type of claw kind of thing.
I guess, but it's the closest thing I could think of for an actual weapon.
So I'd like to do a little something special on the Ruby Radio Show, and this section is called Would You Buy? All right, so the first item we have is a limited edition Ruby Grim prayer candle that could go very famously with your Ruby Ouija board. starting at $10 from the Rooster Seed store, Amber, what do you think? Do you think this is something that you would spend money on?
Not really. Not. I mean, I like scented candles, but
you don't like demonic black candles.
Well, it's not just that. I mean, it looks pretty cool. I just don't feel like buying candles.
No, you're not a freshly scented Febreze type of person.
I am, but I just. But
I mean, I like my room to smell like dead Grim from an alternative universe, if you know what I mean. I'd buy it for $1 just to say, like, I have this demonic candle I light from time to time. And stuff like that. All right, so on to the next one. We have, for $20 on the Rooster Teeth store, Ruby Crow's Flask. 46 people thought it was a really good deal. Amber, your thoughts?
I mean, I get it, but I wouldn't actually drink from because I don't really drink myself. I just like maybe put on a shelf as a little collection thing.
As like a prop?
Yeah.
Would you buy it for $20?
Mm.
I mean, that's kind of high. I mean, I feel like I could get, you know, just a piece of leather, wrap it around a flask and etch the design myself.
How would you?
I would just get a piece of leather, wrap it around and then trace the design. It looks like it's just cut. It just looks like a cut in leather. Doesn't look. Or it looks pressed.
I think it looks pressed.
Yeah, Well, I could probably find a press of some kind, or figure out how to press on leather. I buy it for around... that looks like a $10 product, especially a flask and stuff like that. But I'm not a whiskey man. I'm a moonshiner. All right, on to the next one. We have a Ruby Beacon Academy backpack in a nice sky, not sky blue, but just a regular light blue color with a ruby at the bottom and the emblem of Beacon Academy. $20. So you could buy a flask or you could buy a full-on backpack.
I think I go with the backpack. And I think if you open up the flip, you can see Zwei's head in it. I think that's the backpack that has Zwei's head on it.
Can you actually put stuff in? Like, you trot it around like an actual backpack? Or is there just some stuffed animal that's like you can't get out from the bag?
I think you can actually put stuff in it. I think it's not actually a stuffed Zwei. It's just like a little Zwei's head stitched to the flap.
For $20, yeah, that's actually... It's not a bad backpack. Though, you know, if I were to wear it around, people would be like, oh, what's Beacon Academy? Is that like some sort of university you went to? I'm like, yeah, it's a cool place. It's located up in North Georgia and stuff like that. I had to transfer here because just the prices, there was an infestation problem. moving on, we have a $50 Ruby Signature Stripes hoodie. I don't know if that's men or mediums/black, but for $50,
it's medium. I'm pretty sure it's medium.
I'm pretty sure it's medium too. But you could cop this from the Rooster Teeth store for $50 dues. A very minimalist hoodie, if I were to say so. What do you think, Amber? You think you wear this every day if it's cold outside?
I mean, I already have a bunch of hoodies, maybe one or two that are Ruby related, but I don't think I'd spend $50 on something that. I could buy any other hoodie from somewhere.
I feel like they just put some ketchup, mustard, mayonnaise, and some charcoal and just pressed it or boom, there we go. We got a minimalist jacket. I would buy this because I could wear it around public and people would pick up on the idea, but I wouldn't like look ridiculous wearing some like overzealous like clothing and stuff like that. It's very minimalist and certain people would pick up on the reference. I would not buy it for $50. I think $30, maybe $40, but definitely not $50. A little too high for my liking. Next, one that's up to your alley, Ruby Premium underwear. You wear to bed in those nice cold.
Are you sure those aren't men's boxers?
Well, this is awkward.
I mean, I don't know what women wear and stuff. Women wear boxers? Women don't wear boxers.
I don't think they do.
I don't think they do. Maybe I need to read a Victoria magazine every once in a while. But it is $10 on the Ruby on the Rooster Teeth store. It's premium. It's premium underwear. They have a good charge for it. 13 people gave it 5 stars, so they must think the fabric is something magical. Amber, would you buy it? Or better yet, would you wear it? It's probably pretty comfortable.
Probably.
It's like made of cardboard. Chafing while sleeping.
I mean, $10, not bad. Don't know if I'd wear it though.
I wonder if it's like you get like a pack of 3 for $10. Because if it's just $10 for just one pair of underwear, I don't know. It just seems a little bit high. I go for about $5 because it's somewhat, interestingly designed. I don't know if I'd choose it red though. I'd probably choose it like black with like white outlines. All right, we have a Joinco Ruby unisex painted sweatshirt, hoodie, zippers, hoodie. I think they were just using a bunch of tags, but it's a Ruby hoodie. It's based off the design of Ruby's outfit. It's $25 on Amazon. It looks actually pretty good. I probably pay $25 for that.
Yeah, I'd
rock that. Because I have some like dark pants or like dark clothing and stuff like that, and I could wear that and no one would be the wiser of what it actually means. I don't know so much about the emblem on the front, but no, I buy that. I buy that for the actual price, to be honest. Yeah. What about you, Amber?
I think I'd buy that.
For $25?
Yeah.
Okay. This one from Hot Topic, a ruby green dust crystal necklace so you can look fashionable while it's choking you around.
I actually have one, a yellow dust crystal.
I don't know, man. I'm a fan of bling. I like rocking the golden Rolex and the decked out diamond and gold grill that I have right now. So maybe I might cop it. I don't know. It seems kind of feminine. Hot Topic, not really my type of store. But you already have the yellow one. You can add a green one to your collection.
I could. Or get all of them.
For $10, for around $9?
Yeah, I would.
Hey, it's not a bad idea. Though, I don't know if it's like, you know, plastic or if it's an actual like quartz or something like that, so.
It's plastic.
Oh, it's plastic. That's no fun. I wouldn't buy it. Time for the other one. Now, these ones I thought were really cool. Now, I definitely pay for these, especially for the price, because usually cinch sacks go for a lot higher than that. But even the designs of them, especially the Lai Ren one, kind of looks like a weird, like, not Abercrombie, but like a Nike logo you create yourself. Rocking $30 each. One is a blend. Oh, actually, no. Wait. See, Yang's, Ruby's, Weiss's. I guess Blake's is somewhere. Okay, so it's kind of a blend. It's a blend of each one.
Yeah.
I definitely take the Lyran one. I don't know about the blend one. But for $30, absolutely. What about you, Amber?
I might go with the blend.
You go with the blend?
Yeah.
Is it more colorful?
Yeah.
More spunk?
Yeah, it has all of Team Ruby in it.
I just kind of like the minimalist look of like the Lyran thing. I'm trying to think of like where if I... It's not Nike. It's kind of like an Adidas logo. You know what I'm talking about? The Adidas logo with like the three prongs?
Yeah.
Yeah. That kind of reminded me of it. So I definitely caught that one. Oh, these ones are great. They're keychains. Get your mind out of the gutter, Amber. They're keychains that you can rock on your car keys, your dormitory keys, your house keys, looking fly and everything. $6 a piece. I don't know if you get two or they're dual-sided. I have no idea. Amber, you first.
I do not know.
You don't know? You don't want cute anime girls hanging from your keys and everything?
I mean, I would if they look... Hold on. Like, if they look something like this.
Oh yeah, you got a little, you know, little neoplastic one.
Love from
Neo,
yes.
Okay. Can I copy? Absolutely. You know my boys be loving that hentai shit. Bro, who's on your keys? That bitch is Ruby Rose. How old is she? Legal? Hell yeah. this one was a popular topic on Twitter. They released a purse with Ruby's outfit. It's interesting. I do think her current outfit with all the, you know, laces and zippers and belts and everything, it could technically be called a walking purse. I don't know how much it is. A few people liked it.
I saw it on the RT store, I think 20-something.
20-something. Would you buy it? Would you cop it if it was like for a reasonable price?
No, I really don't do purses.
You don't do purses?
Nah.
I don't know. Maybe if it was like a fanny pack or like, you know, a satchel. Purses are just not a male thing for some reason. I don't know. We need to get with the French fashion, stuff like that. Now the last image we have on the screen is the Ruby Panels girls t-shirt. Now, the ratings doesn't seem too high. It's got a 1 star. Someone must have been pretty ticked from Hot Topic. I think there was a review that the faces look nothing like the ones in the show. But I think that's because the artist wasn't trying to be reminiscent of the show. But nevertheless, it looks a little something. But what would you think? Would you cop it? Would you purchase it?
No, I mean, I already have other Ruby shirts that have like that would have the whole team on it or each individual girl.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't buy that.
Yeah, I wouldn't rock it either. I mean, walking around campus with that thing on your chest, I feel like you get bullied. I feel like you get like pushed in class and like given F's on tests just because you wore that. I just, no, it's not my forte. that is the end of the section, Would You Buy with Ruby Merchandise. I thought that was a little bit interesting. I thought that was a little bit special to throw in.
Mm-hmm.
But we are on to the third part of the interview, which is kind of the critique slash criticism of the show. So you get to vent your frustration out online. So the first hot piece of critique and criticism is, what is your opinion on the Vic Mignogna situation? I know that was coming off the hot streams of Volume 6. This ruptured the news. It got so big that even The Quartering, a gaming news channel, reported on the whole situation, which was a little bit odd because I go to him for gaming news, not, I guess, anime news, but I guess he made some games with his voice actor in it. So, Amber, what is your opinion on it? What did you think about the entire situation?
Honestly, I'm neutral in all that. I mean, I don't really want to pick sides in all this. I mean, what happened to him does suck, but it's been going on even for 10 years. But the thing is, I met him at the 2017 RTX, and up until right now, I've never heard of any of these allegations. I just think that he's a pretty nice guy. Didn't like do anything to make me uncomfortable. Yeah.
So you met him personally, yeah? You met him at like a signing?
Yeah, at RTX. He's pretty cool. I showed him like my little drawing of Crow with a Pokemon partner, which is Honchkrow. Signed it. We got a picture. I was well on my way.
Oh, so he's kind of like very humble in that sense.
Yeah.
But you kind of agree that, you know, he's not like a predator of any kind. He's not like out to get you.
No, never.
To grab that ass.
No, like I said, I've never heard any of these allegations up until like when they actually first said it.
I have, I did a little bit of research on my own before this podcast or radio show, so to say. I saw two pieces of evidence that really just didn't stack up. There was an original post on Twitter that talked about like him grabbing ass and something in the elevator and stuff like that. And then another post where he was just kissing a fan on the cheek. But otherwise than that, I really couldn't find any like video evidence. I couldn't find any interviews with Vic explaining his innocence and stuff like that, or other people coming forth and everything. So,
recently I saw this other YouTuber, Hiro Hay. He's been doing videos like doing these videos regarding Vic Mignogna, and one of the videos he did, he actually hired a legal team to defuse all of this, and that kind of like that in a way kind of like made the quote unquote hashtag kick Vic people like pretty much back off.
Mm-hmm. Well, I always presume innocence until proven guilty.
Yeah.
And I hate to bring, you know, politics into this and stuff like that, but we kind of saw this with the whole Kavanaugh situation, where I feel like he was unjustly brought blame upon before any really evidence could be weighted against him, if there was any. And this is kind of like the same thing with Vic, you know, he's accused of some non-consensual actions and people form kind of this mob mentality of get him out. And Rooster Teeth made that decision to kick Vic from the show Ruby. Now, I want to ask your opinion on what do you think the fallout from the show is? You think Vic might do one more volume and then he's done for the show, they'll kill off his character, or you think it's going to be a whole new voice actor from here on?
I'd say it's a voice actor because Rooster Teeth, like on the business side, not personally, on the business side, it makes sense that they had to like fire him from Rooster Teeth. Because Rooster Teeth, as a company, they don't want anything to do with him. Like I said, business side, that which makes sense. But as for voice acting, maybe, because I have seen a lot of people like posting like potential candidates to be next Crow's voice actor, like Quentin Flynn, who voiced Axel in Kingdom Hearts, Matt Mercer, yeah, who voiced McCree in Overwatch, and this other one, Something Hater, that he voiced Solid Snake. But I think the original, maybe?
Oh, the original Solid Snake?
I think.
Oh, that'd be awesome. I think the Solid Snake voice actor would fit the most because Crow's got this gruff kind of tone. I don't know about the other voice actors you mentioned because I'm not too familiar with those games, like Kingdom Hearts, so to say.
Oh, but, what's the matter with you? It's one of the greatest games out there.
Yeah, that's coming from the person who plays Pokemon all the time.
Not all the time. I love Kingdom Hearts. I mean, because the current Pokemon games, I have beaten it, and that whenever I do replay them, it just kind of lost its
charm.
I guess charm, because you pretty much know what's happening. And the only thing that you could do is either shiny hunt.
Sorry, I haven't played your favorite game of all time. I still think Titanfall 2 is the best, but you haven't played that game.
No, I haven't.
So I'm not bashing you on that point.
Nah.
Seriously, you should pick it up. It's a great game. But moving on to more, not more controversial, but other controversial stuff. The Ruby Games licensed assets from Rooster Teeth that made their appearance in some games they made and others that others have made. The first one is Grim Eclipse. This is a hack and slash, Devil May Cry, kind of tower defense type of game. I saw some gameplay of it, haven't played it myself, but I wanted your opinion on it if you ever played it. What do you think of the game?
It's pretty cool. I did play like a little, in a way, a demo of it, and I think it was the 2013, 2014 RTX. Because originally, actually a fan actually created the game. Like, I don't know out of what, but then Rooster Teeth actually saw it, and now the person who created the game has actually worked with them to make the full game. But for the rest, it's not bad. Kind of like this outside story of it, because we're introduced to a Dr. Merlot, because he's never mentioned in the canon story. So this extra character in this is pretty good, kind of like this new main villain aside from Cinder. I'm Cinder, Salem.
Okay. So you kind of like the game for its story rather than its gameplay?
And it's gameplay too. It's not bad.
What would you rate it out of 10?
Maybe an 8.5. As for why,
really? Not high.
As for why, I don't know. I'm not a game reviewer.
But just your overall feelings of the game?
Yeah.
I seen Shammy do a review on it, and I don't know if that was in a previous state or something like that. Maybe they did some bug fixes and added some game content. It didn't look really interesting to me. I played other hack and slash games, and I feel like they could do. I don't feel like they could do the job better. I just think it's not something I would spend my money on. What are your thoughts on the writers slash creators of the show, Miles and Gary? Now, we talked about this earlier about, Monty's vision and stuff like that. What do you think, or how do you think they're acting slash performing? Do you think that where they are is fine when it comes to the quality of the show, or do you think they need to improve?
I feel like it's fine where they are right now.
Yeah, no, I it's not that, obviously everybody's just trying to help, but the thing that drives me crazy is how people will speak with such a matter-of-fact, I know everything tone. Right. That's the thing that always drives me fucking crazy. There's because you'll get I learned to deal with this just on video comments. People will make a comment, maybe it's a criticism or something, and you go, okay, yeah, that's a fair critique. But you don't want to listen to them because of the way they said it. And sometimes people get in there and they'll talk exactly like they know how the production process works. Oh, this is clearly why this was animated this way. It's motherfucker, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. But the reason I fucking hate you is because you talk like you do and other stupid people listen to you. That's my biggest fucking problem with it.
But like I said, I'm not really too deep into a reviewing. And I just watch it for the sake of watching it and whether I like it or not.
Obviously, you like it.
Yeah.
I like the show too. For the most part, I do think that what you love or what you like should be criticized because, you put on those rose-tinted glasses and everything looks pretty and amazing. And then you take them off. It's oh, there's some problems here that maybe we could fix and maybe improve in the long run and turn a good show into a great show.
Yeah.
But you don't think there's really any big problems with Miles and Carrie as the head of the show?
As far as I know, not really.
Not really?
No.
What about, the idea of Aura, that it's this protective shield? For me, a casual guy just watching it, I thought it was some type of Halo shield, where if it broke, you need to give it time to recharge and stuff like that. Though watching the show and all its fights, you know, it seems to break after them using their semblance. Sometimes they use their semblance and they still have a ton of it left. I feel like it's a little bit inconsistent. And I feel like that was in turn of the world building or the writing or explaining how it works. So could you give your thoughts on it? I mean, that's just one aspect that I noticed just as watching as a casual person, you know. There's probably some other examples that I could, you know, talk about. I could talk about the walking cycles, talk about Jean becoming Gary Stu. There's some other things, but, you know, just
like,
you know,
I said, I really don't know. I just watch it for the sake of watching it. I don't really pay attention to like any like little aspects that need to be changed or stays the same.
But still, what is your opinion on the whole aura thing? What do you think it should be?
Don't really know, honestly.
You just don't care?
Huh?
You just don't care, or you just don't know?
I just don't care.
Well, usually, like, when I watch something, you know, when I come out of a movie theater, I like to think, oh, you know, this was a 9 out of 10. I think this could have been, you know, I didn't really care for that scene or something like that. So, you know, maybe just me giving my concerns, and hopefully you'll get picked up by someone who could really voice it to them. But, you know, I'm just trying to find, you know, other people who might, like, love the show but want to see it improved in a way. Another question is, now, I don't know too much about this, but apparently Aaron and Barbara are doing like some type of online chatting between the audience or something on like Instagram or Facebook or FaceTime.
Are bees officially a couple? I mean, it feels like it, doesn't it? I don't know what happens in the next volume, but it really feels like that's the case. Like, I don't think they're just going to start dating right now. I think they've started to realize that they have feelings for each other.
Yes, I saw a bit of those.
What is that about? Because I'm a little bit ill-informed about that.
Because it kind of like represented the characters, Yang and Blake, because people kept thinking, like, there's like two sides of this. Like, people are like going for Bumblebee, but people are going against Bumblebee. And I guess Aaron and Barbara kind of like teasing them. I don't really know. I don't really like stick around and watch those.
Now, I know you already stated your thoughts on Volume 6 and what you thought of it. Do you think like any areas of Volume 6 there could have been an addition or subtraction of something that would make it better? Or do you think where it is right now is good and nothing needs to be changed?
I think where it is right now is fine.
So like them, just the events of Volume 6 and them heading to Atlas would be good?
Yeah.
I feel like Volume 6 should have been where Volume 5 was. I just feel like Volume 4 was kind of like procrastination, where they're just walking to their destination. And then when they get to their destination, they're still kind of procrastinating, but there's some action. I just think that a volume could have been cut and then just move it down and no one would really notice the difference. Because in 3, they're already heading to this location. You know, the time difference between 3 and 4 is 6 months. You think they would be there by then and stuff like that. So if I were to say anything about Volume 6, I'd just say it should have happened earlier than it would right now. What do you think about that?
I don't really know, honestly.
You don't know or just don't care?
Yeah, I just don't care.
You're very laissez-faire with the show.
Yeah, but like I said, I really don't care about reviewing it. I just watch it for the sake of watching it.
I mean, you react to it. I feel like you would have some type of opinions on it. I mean, you react to it when every episode comes out. I just feel I didn't like this about this part of the episode, or, oh, I feel like they could have done that, or something like that.
Well, I rarely ever say something like that. I mean, I just watch it, like, if there's, like, a revelation, like, it's, like, a story plot, then, yeah, I'd react to that. But if there's something I don't, that should have been different, I couldn't have pointed it out, or wouldn't point it out.
Okay.
Or just don't notice it.
All right. That's fine. Yeah, for the final question of the show, what do you wish for in the upcoming volume or volumes? What is a type of fantasy or idea that you think could be put to paper, or in this case, put to the animation software?
Like, what do you mean? Like a story or what?
Like an event that might happen. So, for example, I wish in the upcoming, maybe volume 7 or 8, that there is some type of Grim Invasion and it gets to show off the firepower and the dictatorial power of Atlas. They're using these large cannons to take out these swarms of Grim to prevent people from freaking out and everything.
I mean, it could happen. I mean, if you saw the post credit for volume 6, Salem is making her own flying monkeys.
And I was just asking what your idea of what you think could happen.
Well, kind of thinking like maybe Penny would come back. I mean, yeah, she was sliced and diced in volume 3, but she is a robot. She could just easily be rebuilt.
So you're hoping for the Penny to come back to the show?
Yeah, and like, but it would be like in a way, a new version of Penny where Ruby like excited to meet, excitedly that she saw Penny alive, but the Penny that we're currently watching, not the Penny that we saw in Volume 3, but the new Penny would be like, hello, I do not believe we have met. And then Ruby would be like down, like really, really upset because Penny like wouldn't recognize it because this is technically a new Penny with no memories of her.
So either like a personality change or amnesia or some type
not
of...
Not amnesia. I mean, that's one... Not amnesia, but like a program, like in a way, a fresh start, like a new Penny, no amnesia whatsoever, just like a new Penny, like that actually met Ruby for the first time.
Well, it's kind of like a memory loss, you know, if you met someone and then you forgot about.
But it's not amnesia or anything. it's not amnesia, like a new Penny, like. No amnesia involved. Like a new Penny. Like a new body.
Like same yes. Soul, different body. Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to get you angry. I'm just trying to figure out like what you meant. Like you said new Penny. And I'm like, oh, so like a completely fresh start.
No.
That's not too bad. That could definitely happen. Maybe they're actually planning for that. I would like to figure out who the guy in volume 3. You know, where his hands, he does the Arthur thing where like he bangs on his chair and stuff like that. I'd love to figure out who he is.
Oh, I think that's Penny's father.
Right, yeah, I'd like to, you know, if Penny were to come back, I would love to know more about the backstory or why was she created or how her soul was captured into a robotic body and stuff like that. You know, more lore.
I want to say that Penny is kind of like, in a way, a recreation of Dr. Paulandina's actual daughter, Penny, like her flesh and blood daughter. But she died some way, then Dr. Paulandina like couldn't take her loss well, so she just built a new Penny to like fill in the gap.
I think that's a great thought of what is to come. I think mine is a little bit of a stretch. That's why I gave it like a volume or two volumes, because I don't expect them to, you know, whip up this giant battle scene and create conflict for the sake of conflict. I think it needs time to mellow. It needs time to think it out. What's going on? Why is this happening? But you never know. You never know what could happen in these upcoming volumes. And I wish the best for the writers, creators, animators, storyboard artists, and stuff like that. I wish the best. I hope the show turns out excellent. I do think it has, you know, a couple issues, but I look forward to the best of things. And that, ladies and gentlemen, concludes the Ruby Radio Show with Miss Amber here. Do you have anything to say before we close down?
Yeah, so just remember to stay awesome, be nice to animals, don't be dicks, keep moving forward.
Thank you all for coming, and good night.